Hi, this is Amr Abdelgawad. In this lecture, we're going to discuss a very important topic, which is limb length discrepancy or limb length inequality. So what are the objectives of this lecture? First, we'd like to list the causes of limb length discrepancy in children, and then we're going to explain the effects of limb length discrepancy on hips, spine, and gait. We're going to describe the clinical presentation of limb length discrepancy in general, and then we're going to explain how to detect the final limb length discrepancy, that means the limb length discrepancy at the end of growth, and then we're going to outline the management of children presenting with limb length discrepancy. This lecture is going to be general on the topic of limb length discrepancy. We're going to have later on lectures on specific topics like fibular hemimelia or limb length discrepancy due to previous trauma. A good source that you can use is this book, Pediatric Orthopedic Handbook for Primary Care Physician, written by myself and Dr. Naga. So what are the causes that can lead to limb length discrepancy? There are congenital causes like femoral deficiency. The old name for femoral deficiency is proximal femoral focal deficiency. However, we use the word femoral deficiency now as this is a more broader term. Fibular hemimelia, this is one of the common causes. Coxa vara can cause limb length discrepancy, tibial hemimelia, pseudoarthrosis of the tibia because of some bone loss can cause limb length discrepancy, and hemihypertrophy will cause lengthening on the affected side. Among these, the most two important causes of congenital limb length discrepancy is femoral deficiency and fibular hemimelia. So femoral deficiency and fibular hemimelia are the most common causes of congenital limb length discrepancy. Infectious causes for limb length discrepancy like osteomyelitis. Osteomyelitis can affect the growth plate, and this can actually cause shortening or lengthening of the affected extremity. Trauma, it can cause a shortening through the fracture. So if the fracture is over, fracture ends are overlapping, that will cause shortening of the affected side. Also, if it can cause damage to the growth plate, which will lead to shortening of the affected side. Tumor also can affect, can cause limb length discrepancy, like multiple hereditary exostoses. This can affect the growth plate and can result in having one limb which is shorter than the other. There is neurological causes of limb length discrepancy because the weak side usually becomes shorter, like if you have a hemiplegic cerebral palsy or you have polio, the affected side ends shorter than the other side. All these are different causes for limb length discrepancy. As we said, we will make separate lectures for fibular hemimelia and congenital femoral deficiency. However, this is a quick introduction for the condition. Fibular hemimelia, the affected side is shorter than the other side. So this is the affected side. Here is the right side, shorter than the left side. The fibula is short or deficient in relation to the tibia. So if you can see here, it's shorter than the tibia. It should go a little bit higher up. Some cases has complete deficiency of the fibula. Usually there is a deficiency of the ankle bones. So if you see here, there is loss of carpal bone missing. The talus heel here is fused with the calcaneus. Also there is deficiency of the lateral rays in the fibular hemimelia. So this girl has only three toes. There is deficiency of the other two rays. This is an example of shortening that happened due to injury to the growth plate. This is a 13-year-old girl that 5 years ago she had an injury to her left femur, the distal part, that resulted in affection of the growth plate. If you see, you can see here the growth plate as you can see it here. So here is the growth plate here. You can see it very clearly. Here you can see the growth plate because the injury that happened here, that resulted in premature closure, and that resulted on this patient having 5 centimeter difference. So this femur here, that's the end of the femur here, and this is the end of this femur. If you see, there is 5 centimeter shortening. So this is an example of post-traumatic shortening due to injury to the growth plate. So what are the effects of limb length discrepancy? The significance of limb length discrepancy remains controversial because most people have a difference of the length of their extremities that can go up to 1.5 centimeters. That's why most authors think that a discrepancy up to 2 centimeters usually does not require any active intervention. More than 2 centimeters, we try to treat that limb length discrepancy to avoid the effect of limb length discrepancy on the hips, spines, and the gait, as we're going to see later on. Let's see the effects of limb length discrepancy on the gait. If you see this line, this is the up and down movement of the pelvis during gait for people who does not have limb length discrepancy. And if you see, this movement is very small. For patients who have limb length discrepancy, this up and down movement gets bigger, which result in increased energy during gait and also will result in increased force of impact on the affected side. What about the effects of limb length discrepancy on hips and sacroiliac joint? This is an x-ray for a patient of limb length discrepancy. Right side is shorter than the left side, as you can see here. This angle is called the central edge angle, and it's a representation of the coverage of the hip. And if you see here on the long side, the hip is less covered than on the short side. So limb length discrepancy causes partial uncoverage of the long side. Also, it causes stresses on the sacroiliac joint. Sacroiliac joint is these joints between the ilium and the sacrum, and this stress is usually more on the long side. This is a finite element study that I was part of, and it showed that limb length discrepancy can have increased stresses on sacroiliac joint, especially on the long side. So let's discuss the assessment of patient coming with limb length discrepancy. As usual, it will be history, physical exam, and then we'll go for MRI. So what is the history that you'd like to get for a child presenting with limb length discrepancy? First, you have to ask about congenital condition. Ask if this shortening had been detected since birth or shortly after to see if this is a congenital condition or not. Also ask about trauma or infection that may have caused limb length discrepancy. Very important is to ask about previous lengthening surgeries, because if this patient had a previous lengthening surgery, that will affect your calculation for the final limb length discrepancy that this child will have at the end of his growth. Let's proceed to the physical exam of a child presenting with limb length discrepancy. First thing is you look for the Galeazzi sign. So what you do is you bend the hip and you bend the knees and make the feet at the same level. So you bend the hips, knees, and make the feet at the same level, and then you assess the relationship of the knees in both sides, both from the AP and from the lateral position, to detect if there is limb length discrepancy or not. So if you see this child, he has the hips bend, he has the knee bend also, and then the feet are at the same level, and then you assess from the front and from the side the level of the knee. It's obvious here that the left knee is at the higher level, and you can see that very obviously in the from the front and from the side, that the left knee is at a higher level than the right knee. This means that the left side is longer than the right side. This is another patient with limb length discrepancy, and this is a positive Galeazzi sign, so the hips and knee are bent. And then from the front, if you assess the left knee and the right knee, you can obviously see here that the left knee is at a higher level than the right knee. Another method of assessment of limb length discrepancy is assessment of the levels of the anterior superior spine. So you ask the patient to stand straight, making sure that he or she does not bend the knees, and the feet is on the floor, and then you assess the level of the anterior superior iliac spine. So you put your thumb on the anterior superior iliac spine on each side, and if there is a limb length discrepancy, as in this case, one thumb will be higher than the other. Now let's discuss imaging of limb length discrepancy. So if you suspect that the child has a limb length discrepancy, you have to get an x-ray of the entire extremity, and this x-ray has to show from hips to ankles on both sides so you can compare. Patient has to be standing straight, so you don't get an x-ray which can give you false results, and there is two ways to get that x-ray, either by using a long film or using a scanogram, as we're going to see now. This is an example of a long x-ray of a four-year-old girl with a fibular hemimelia. So this is a clinical picture of the girl. She has a left side fibular hemimelia, so her left lower extremity is shorter than the right lower extremity. This is the long x-ray taken. If you see here, this is the left lower leg. Obviously, the left fibula is much shorter than the left tibia, so she has a fibular hemimelia. The left lower leg in general is shorter than the right lower leg. And then the long x-rays can show us the details of the alignment, can show us the total limb length discrepancy. So this line is drawn at the end of the proximal femur here. This line here is drawn grown at the end of the proximal femur on the right side. So the difference between these two lines is the total limb length discrepancy. So this is the long X-ray. It has the advantage that it can show the alignment, it can show the whole bone, and it is one X-ray shot for the patient. This is an example of a scanogram. Scanogram is on one cassette, you get an X-ray of the hip, and then X-ray of the knees, and then X-rays of the ankle. The child has to stay still while moving the cassette, and it cannot be used at the alignment because you don't see the whole bone, so you cannot use it to see the alignment or to assess the alignment of this patient. So let's discuss now predicting the final limb length discrepancy in children. What does this mean? So if you have a child, 5-year-old, that has a fibular hemimelia, and right now she has about 6 centimeter difference between both sides, what are you going to tell the family? What will be the final limb length discrepancy when this girl reaches final maturity? Or if you have a child that is 11-year-old who has gross disturbance of his distal femur due to a trauma and he's not growing from that side, what will be the final limb length discrepancy when he reaches skeletal maturity? This is very important for counseling patients. The arithmetic method, this is a rough estimation of the remaining growth, and it has four assumptions: that boys stop growing at the age of 16, girls stop growing at the age of 14 years old, the distal femur grows about 1 centimeter a year, and the proximal tibia grows about 6 millimeter a year. This is a very rough estimation because the age at the stop of the growth vary too much between different boys and girls. So these numbers, 16 and 14, can vary greatly between different boys and different girls. So it's only a rough estimation, and it's used mainly in cases of limb length discrepancy due to injury. So if you have a child, for example, 14-year-old, who had an injury of the distal femur that resulted in closure of the growth plate, you can assume that this child he's 14, and usually boys end growing at the age of 16, so he lost about 2 years of growth, and each year there is about 10 millimeter of growth from the distal femur, so this child lost about 20 millimeter or 2 centimeter of his expected length, so he may end up having about 2 centimeter limb length discrepancy. The second method that you can use to detect the final limb length discrepancy is PD multiplier method. And it says that the predicted limb length discrepancy, which means the limb length discrepancy at the end of the growth, is the current difference multiplied by the lower limb multiplier, as we're going to see in the next slide. And in this one, we use the chronological age, so it means that we use the patient's age chronologically. We don't have to get a skeletal age of the patient, and it's mainly used for congenital causes like femoral deficiency and fibular hemimelia and hemiatrophy or hypertrophy. So this is the equation again: the predicted limb length discrepancy, the final limb length discrepancy, equals the current difference multiplied by lower limb multiplier. So for example, let's say that a patient, female with a limb, with a fibular hemimelia, she's a 3-year-old, and her current limb length discrepancy is 5 centimeter. So if we go to a 3-year-old female, the multiplier is about 2, so that means at the end of her growth, the limb length discrepancy will be the current difference, which is 5 centimeter by 2, that equal about 10 centimeter. Another example, let's say that we have a 7.5-year-old boy with congenital femoral deficiency, and his current difference is 4 centimeter. His multiplier is about 1.5, so that means that his the limb length discrepancy at the end of his growth will be the current one, which is 4 centimeter by 1.5, that's equal about 6 centimeter. Remember, there is a multiplier for boys and there is a multiplier for girls, and remember, what we use is the lower limb multiplier and not the height multiplier, which gives you an indication of the final length of the patient, not the difference. So we use the lower limb multipliers, and you have to use either boys or girls. A good number to remember that children reach half of their growth at the age of 3 years old for females and at the age of 4 years old for a male. So whatever difference you have, if you are 3-year-old girl or a 4-year-old boy, is basically about half of the difference that you will have at the end of the growth. Currently, there is some smart apps that use the multipliers, and you can download them and use them for your patients. So now, after we have discussed the arithmetic method and the Paley multiplier method, the third one is the straight line graph method, or what's called Mosley method. And this method is a little bit more complicated. It may be more accurate, but it required multiple visits, and also it required using the skeletal edge by getting an X-ray of the left hand. To make it a little bit easier, there is a website now that can be used for the straight line method, and through the website you can put the data and it will help you to define the final limb length discrepancy. So let's discuss now the treatment options for limb length discrepancy. So for children who have limb length discrepancy, you have two options. You can either lengthen the short side or you can shorten the long side. Lengthening can be done by two methods. Shoe lift, it means that you put a shoe lift on the affected side, or you can do actual surgical lengthening of the short side. How to shorten the long side, there is also two options. You can do acute shortening, it means that you take a piece of the bone, or you can control the growth of the physis, and by that time you decrease the growth of the long side, allowing the short side to catch up. So let's discuss now the treatment goals in cases of limb length discrepancy. As we said, there is lots of asymptomatic individual that has limb length discrepancy up to 1.5 centimeter. So most authors will agree that up to 2 centimeters, no treatment is required. From 2 to 5 centimeter, most people will use a shoe lift on the short side, or a stopping of the growth of the long side, which is called epiphyseodesis, or actual shortening of the long side. From 5 to 20 centimeter, most authors will go for lengthening of the short side, which may be combined with other procedure like shortening of the long side. For a difference which is predicted to be more than 20 centimeter, most people will go for prosthetic fitting. It means that they will amputate the foot and apply a prosthesis. Very important that these treatment goals are not rigid. These work as a guideline, but there is lots of surgeons that will have different opinion. So there is a surgeon that will treat limb length discrepancy that is less than 2 centimeter. There is lots of people that will lengthen a difference that is expected to be more than 20 centimeter. And there's also lots of families that don't accept amputation and they would like to go for repeated lengthening procedures, even if they expected the difference is more than 20. So again, these act as a guideline. However, different surgeons may have different opinions. So I'd like to show you a few examples here for cases of limb length discrepancy. So this is a girl that has a fibular hemimelia on the right side. You can see here that obviously her right lower extremity is shorter than her left lower extremity. She has the X-ray picture of a fibular hemimelia. Her fibula is shorter than the tibia. She has some foot deformity. She has missing rays. So decision was taken for lengthening of this patient. So lengthening is done by different method. The most commonly used method is by something called distraction osteogenesis by external fixator. It means that we apply external fixator, which is this device, and then we do a bone cut, which is called osteotomy, and then we distract the two bone ends to lengthen this bone. So we apply the external. Here she is in the follow-up 2 weeks after the surgery, so the external fixator is there. The patient lengthened the distance between the two rings by moving the struts, which is our this structure. And then when they lengthen these struts, they increase the distance between these two rings. And because each ring is attached to one side of the bone, you will get distraction of the bone, as you can see here in this area. And we usually continue till about 5 centimeter, or depending on how far the patient can tolerate. If you see here 2 weeks after the surgery, you can see separation here. You can see separation here in the X-ray. This is the X-ray from the side. Also, you can see the separation here and here. Later on, this area is going to fill by bone, and this bone will be lengthened by this amount of distraction. Here it is 14 weeks after the surgery when we decided to stop lengthening. You can see all the way from here to here, this is a new bone that is formed by distraction osteogenesis. So this is a follow-up x-ray for this patient. You can see she lengthened 5 centimeters, which is from here to here, and then this bone gradually filled in, and now it's remodeling. These are the sides of the old pins. Gradually, this also is going to remodel. So this is an x-ray here for her in the follow-up. You can see the lengthening here has remodeled nicely. Still, she has limb length discrepancy, so we decided to do epiphyseodesis of the other side. So we started to stop the growth of the other side to allow this side to catch on. So this is what's called plate epiphyseodesis. It means we put a plate, one screw above and one screw below the growth plate on both sides. Here is one screw above, one screw below the growth plate. That will stop this growth plate from growing, and this will allow to give the short side some time to catch the long side. So in this patient, you saw two methods of attacking the limb length discrepancy: by lengthening this side and stopping the growth from the proximal tibia to allow the short side to catch. This is another example. This is a 20-year and 4-month-old girl. She has a hemangioma on the left side. The hemangioma caused increased growth of the affected side because there is more blood supply here. So this side is longer than this side by 5 centimeters. So this is a long x-ray for this patient, and to avoid bending the knee when the patient is standing, we ask them to step on blocks, different length blocks according to what you estimate on the short side. So we got a good extension of both knees and get a good x-ray. So she has a 5 centimeter or 2-inch block on the short side here, the right side, and this caused her to be equal here. So we know that the difference is the shoe lift that she has, which is 2 inches or 5 centimeter. So this is the long x-ray showing that the upper part of both femur is equal, but we know that she's stepping on 2 inches here of lift. So this patient has a difference of 5 centimeters. We got an x-ray of her hand to know her skeletal age. So her skeletal age was 12 years. That means that she has about because this patient is skeletally about 12 year old, we decided to stop the growth of both the distal femur and the proximal tibia to give her opportunity to catch with the short side, which is the right side, with the left side, the long side. And here she is 2 years after the surgery. When she is done her growing, that 5 centimeter difference became now about 1 centimeter difference. So in this case, we did not use lengthening, we used shortening or stopping of the growth of the long side, and we were able to decrease the difference from 5 centimeter to about 1 centimeter. Another case you can see here, this is a patient who has a limb length discrepancy, congenital short femur. Right side here is shorter than the left side. There is about 2.6 centimeter difference, and we use the same principle of lengthening distraction osteogenesis. However, we did not use an external fixator. We use an internal fixator, in this case internal fixator that can lengthen by using electromagnetic impulse from a distant a remote control that is put on the patient body. So this is the, we put that nail in the patient, that nail distract by a sort of a magnetic remote control. And if you see, we did the bone cut here, and then we're going to lengthen that nail, which is going to distract the bone. If you see here, this is a final follow-up for this patient. She is perfectly equal. This is the area of the bone growth that she has, and if you see here, the nail had distracted with this amount of lengthening that we intended to do. Thank you very much. All my videos are for educational purpose only. Please consult your doctor before any decision.